All right, welcome to Introduction to Ethics, Phil 103, Section 9, CRN 11539, Winter 2017, online. I'm Grant Yoakum. I'm going to be your instructor for the course. I like doing these courses because this is actually my office in Canada right now. I'm a commuter. I live in Windsor. I cross the border. I teach at Oakland University. I've been doing so for, this starts my 13th year. Which is lucky somehow, I think. But just so you know, I am on campus Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, and have office hours on campus from 11:45 till 12:45. My office is located in MSC, that's the Math and Sciences Center, 642. So if you have any questions or want to meet with me to talk about the material, the readings, the assignments, anything along those lines, office hours is the place to do that. You also have my email address, which is yoakum@oakland.edu, right at the top of your course syllabus, which is the purpose of this video today. I have a printed copy. You can find them on Moodle. And please, as you're viewing this video, open the syllabus and follow through, because I'm going to go over it in detail. So I've been teaching these courses at Oakland University since, it's January 2005, so long time. My first course was Introduction to Ethics. I've just recently completed a PhD, so if you're so inclined, you may call me doctor. I don't prefer it or anything along those lines. I'm pretty casual. So this will be a virtual course, and most of your instruction, from my end at least, will come from through Moodle, through YouTube videos like this one. Making it your responsibility to check Moodle regularly and stay up to date with the class. And what is it? The fourth page lists off a whole series of important dates and a tentative schedule for the course. Life happens sometimes, so that schedule may alter slightly, but I'll do so in as fair and considerate a way as possible. Thing they put and make me put on the first page of the syllabus is the course catalog description and the course objectives. There are a few important things in here. It starts off by saying it's a major ethical analysis of right and wrong, good and evil, from the ancient Greeks to the present. So they want it to be one, Western, and two, on top of that, historical, right? Because if you jump down to the course objectives, you'll find one of the objectives is to introduce students to the important historical texts and ethical theory, and to show how theories about ethics have developed over time. So it's got to be a historical introduction. That's why we are starting with Socrates and ending with Jean-Paul Sartre, who passed away in the 80s. Right, so that gets us pretty close in philosopher's terms to contemporary ethical theory. The other thing in the course objectives, there are just the last three of them here, are important to develop students' facility in reading and analyzing theories learned in class. So what I'm going to be testing you on is your ability to analyze, to critique, to critically evaluate these ethical theories. Second from the bottom, to develop students' facility in writing creatively and clearly about ethical questions. So I'm going to make you write, and I have to. You see, this is, and then finally, to help students learn how to apply ethical theory to concrete situations. So I'll always be illustrating with examples. So this course catalog description and the course objectives are basically the box this course has to fit in. Within that box, I've got a certain degree of leeway with regard to how I introduce you to this material, but nonetheless, these are the things that the course has. So it's got to be writing intensive, it's got to be historical, it's got to involve some concrete situations, and it's got to test your ability to read and analyze theory, right? Put into language, put into writing. So, so these are the things the course has to do. And to that end, I have picked a pile of textbooks for you. Don't freak out yet. We're not going to read the entirety of any one of these books. Many of them, especially the Hackett ones, which is the bulk of the texts for this course, you should be able to find online somehow or other. But nonetheless, especially the Hackett ones and the Oxford one, which has been in publication a long time, you should be able to find used. And they don't start off that expensive in the first place. It's not so long ago that I was a student, and I remember how bloody expensive textbooks could be. Now, another way I could have done this course is had to buy an anthology, something along these lines. But these things run between $90 and $130. I like how I do it a little bit better. These books are exactly what I want to focus in on. And on top of that, they wind up being a bit cheaper for you. So there are, believe it or not, seven of them for this course, but it's, like I say, don't freak out yet. In Plato's Five Dialogues, we're reading two of those five dialogues. Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics, there are 10 books to this Nicomachean Ethics. We are going through books 1, 2, and like the first section of 3, right? So, big looking book. We end off where? Like here. So we're going through that much of this book. Kant's grounding for the metaphysic of morals. We're going through the preface in the first two sections of that. And it's a skinny little book, but don't let that deceive you. He's a bugger. John Stuart Mill's Utilitarianism, I think. I assigned sections 1, 2, and 3. 1, 2, and 3. And just the first section of John Stuart Mill's On Liberty. Nietzsche's Beyond Good and Evil preface and first two sections. I think there are seven. Am I wrong? Nine sections. We're just going through the first two. And then Jean-Paul Sartre's Existentialism and Human Emotions. We are going, 50 pages into this one? Yeah, 51. So, that far. Anyhow, those will be your textbooks for the class. I've picked them also because they represent different periods in ethical philosophy. So, Ancient Ethics, pretty well a straightforward account of excellence, right? Just ethics has to do with being excellent at being a human being. Right? What does that mean? It means something interesting in the context of a democracy. It means something more interesting in terms of Aristotle's analysis of virtue ethics. A modern ethical theory, and modern being sort of Enlightenment ethical theory, we're starting off with Immanuel Kant, who's got an account of duty. And John Stuart Mill, who's got an account, of course, of liberty and utility, right? So this is utilitarian ethics, right? And then we move to, we consider this postmodern, not a term I'm all the way happy with, but nonetheless, postmodern ethics. With Nietzsche and his Beyond Good and Evil, which is a critical appraisal of ethical theory to date. Largely a new disposition towards being critical and engaged in human life and crafting your actions in terms of a theme of health, right? And then existentialism and human emotions. Jean-Paul Sartre is going to explore largely the reality of the situation you're in when you make a choice in terms of freedom and responsibility. And then on top of that, really three emotional dispositions that are completely normal, and if you're not experiencing them, you're probably hiding running away from the full consequences of your involvement in the ethical landscape. So these are emotions that are proper to that you should feel, right, given the situation of moral responsibility pinned to freedom, right? Now, those are your textbooks. All of them are required. I require you to do the reading. I really don't care where you get them, but I've ordered them through the OU bookstore. So they should be there. They tend to send them back if they are not purchased by a certain date. So get those books soon, or find those books somehow. There are a few other online sources. I use Abe Books because they have great large quantities of used. It's sort of a clearinghouse for smaller booksellers, so that's a good resource. You could probably find them on Amazon, that sort of thing. You'll find when you search them online that they're cheap, and they don't start all that expensive, even if you're buying them new at the OU bookstore. So those are your books. We're going to do some reading. Now, I've written a course description here, which is, we're still on the first page of the syllabus. And it reads like this: in general terms, the term ethics denotes sets of standards that serve to govern to govern conduct and serve as a sort of tablet by which particular actions may be judged. So ethics has to do to some extent with making an ethical judgment, right? Permissible, impermissible, good, evil, right, wrong, etc. Right? Throughout the history of philosophy, the question of how one ought to live and act has dominated the theoretical field, as we'll see from our readings right from the beginning. How should we act? What should we do? Was in the mindset of these ancient theorists, right? These questions only make sense upon the assumption that we are free and that, in some sense, our actions and dispositions are choices. So an ethics course is about freedom and how to manage your freedom. Right? Taken in light, an ethics class is about freedom. In this course, we will study six distinct but related attempts to form a basis for substantive ethical judgments, ones with teeth, ones that mean something, ones that are robust and hold and in some sense obligate us, from the history of Western philosophy, each resting upon distinct accounts of human freedom. We'll examine each of these arguments in order to produce a well-rounded understanding of the nature of the debate surrounding ethical theory and practice within Western philosophy. And given that, I don't want you to think like any of these guys. I want you to think like you, right? What these guys do is situate you in sort of a longer dialogue with regard to ethical theory and give you the tools to formulate reasoned decisions and choices and actions of your own, right? So this isn't a course about you should act this way. This is a course that raises theoretical problems, dilemmas, you know, issues with regard to your situation as a free human being that has to make choices, and those choices exist in a sort of human reality, right, with consequences, right, in the context of responsibilities to ourselves and others, and we'll explore this throughout the course, right? So, great breakdown. There are going to be three tests, and this semester I have decided that these tests are going to be a bit shorter, generally four or five questions related to the theorists, right? So there are six theorists. I've broken the course into two. So the first test will be Socrates, Aristotle. The second test will be Kant and Mill, the skinnier books that we're studying. And then the final test, which will be Nietzsche and Jean-Paul Sartre. right? So each of these tests are not going to be comprehensive. That is, they will study, or they will question only the two theorists at issue, right? So that's how they will go. There were 20% each, so I tend to have these tests total to 20 points, right? So if it's four questions, 5 points. Excuse me, each, if it's five questions, 4 points each. So, total of 20. Generally, the questions will, so I wrote a description of this, short answer questions asking you to define a term, make an important distinction related to a particular philosopher. The questions will be designed to test both reading comprehension and a more general understanding of the ideas that we've studied. That is, readings and all of the video material are fair game for this. So if I post something to Moodle, that's required, right? This is going to be video heavy, it's going to be reading heavy. It's just what we need to do in the context of an online environment. In an on-campus environment, we could sit down and have long conversations about this material, but we are online, so largely it's going to be back and forth. I post something, you respond to it through the forums, etc., etc. Right? These tests will be posted to Moodle at the end of each section, covered by the quiz. I indicate the dates on your schedule page. You will have 5 days to engage with this test material. Your responses will be submitted through Moodle. The due dates for each quiz are indicated below. We got to keep this semester on track. I'm going to try and avoid a situation where we need a lot of extensions. And how I do this is give you 5 days with the material. Right? So in an on-campus test, you would come in, you would write the test. I would accept the test, and that was the test day. Right? You would have, an hour and 10 minutes or something along those lines to write the test. Well, these are essentially open book tests. You've got all of your resources in front of you, and you have 5 days to engage with this material. So hopefully you should be able to plan your time so that you can get it done within that 5 days. In each case, I give you the weekend at least for it, right? So you should be able to engage with this material in that period of time. Discussion forum participation. Each of these theorists is going to come with some sort of a discussion topic, a question that I formulate to sort of get the discussion ball rolling, right? So I might isolate a passage of text, right? I might isolate a potential problem with the theory that we're studying. I might ask you to explore a metaphor or an example that I've introduced to you, et cetera, et cetera. And you're expected to engage in each of these forums, right? Start conversations, enter into debates. This is your rough workspace for the class, right? So it's generally what you're trying to do collectively with one another is develop an understanding of this material. I hope for this to be an ongoing conversation between you, the students, and this class. And this is, like I say, your rough workspace. So I generally leave that to you, right? So I apply a grade to it, right? Because we've got to participate and engage in these conversations and that sort of thing. It's an important element of the class. And that grade is 15% of your final grade, right? So this can be, if you fail to do these forms or don't do them completely, it can be a significant detractor from your grade. So your best to just kind of stay on top of it. When I turn to the discussion forums, this is how I assess them. I ask myself three questions when I assign grades for this. Have you posted at least once for each topic? More is better. The idea here is to foster an ongoing conversation about the issues raised by the material at hand. right. Secondly, are the posts substantial? Right? Do they show engagement with the material? Is there evidence you've read and thought about this? Right? Have you offered some sort of an analysis or an attempt to answer, even if you're posting a question? It's perfectly acceptable to post a question, hey, I'm not understanding this. If I'm on the right track, it might be this. Can you offer me some help? Right? Might be a good way to respond to these forums. All I'm looking for is evidence that you've tried to think this through on your own, right? And then thirdly, are the posts timely? That is, did you do them as the discussion was going on, or did you merely try to satisfy the assignment requirement by the imposed deadline? This is the funny thing about these discussion forums. Once I post them, I don't post them before you've engaged with the material, but once I post them, as you're engaging with the material, I leave them open all semester. I do this for good reason. The material, it relates to one another. So you will find Nietzsche engaging with Socrates, for example. You will find a similarity between something Aristotle argued and something Immanuel Kant argues, right? You will find there's a great deal of debate between Kant and Mill. You will find something similar to Kant in Jean-Paul Sartre, though you will find something similar to Socrates in Sartre as well, right? So, et cetera, et cetera, right? So, as you're hitting each of these theorists, you might want to go back and revisit your earlier posts, right? So I leave them open for that entire period of time. This also means that you've got access to that portion of your grade for the entire semester. That's 15% of your grade. That right up until the end of class in April, which is April 24th, all of these forms close. That's last call. Right, so I leave it to you to engage with these forums in a timely, effective, and substantial kind of manner. And I hope that really they're not supposed to be, oh, geez, I got to do this forum. Hopefully, they'll be fun, engaging, and interesting, and great places to test out your own ideas. Right. Aside from that, on the tests and on your writing assignment, you have to be right. You know, it's one of the things I look for on a test is, do you understand the material? Have you interpreted correctly the theorist at hand? On the forums, I just need the post to be evidence of your attempt to understand the material. You don't have to be so much right on that 15% of your grade, right? Just do them, participate, and you'll get a good grade on that section, right? So it's designed to help you, frankly, right? So those are the discussion forums. There's going to be a writing project for this course. It's a final writing project. It comes in with your final test on the 24th of April. This is going to be a 1,000 to 1,250 word reflection paper, right? Directed towards your choice between three course overview questions, which I'll compose throughout the course. These questions, I've done this a lot of times in the past. These questions are super, super, super general, right? Meaning that you can interpret them and refine them as you go. They may reflect the forum discussions, themes from the readings, or the material from the video content provided. But like I say, I tend towards super general. In the past, they've all started given the argument studied in this course. And then I ask you some question about freedom, right? Or responsibility, or the role of the faculty of reason, which is going to be a big topic in this course, etc. Right? So these questions, I'm going to post them midway through the semester. I've got my calendar here, and I think I'm going to post them right before your reading week, which starts on the 18th and ends on the 26th of February. That way you can start thinking during your reading, winter recess, about the writing assignment, just get the ball rolling, that sort of thing. So that is how you will be assessed. Oh, and I'm going to have you ahead of the writing project through a forum make a writing project proposal. There should be a substantial proposal, and more instructions will follow on that. It's worth 5% of your final grade. So three tests, 20 each, that's 60%. Discussion forums, another 15%, that's up to 75. Writing project proposal, another 5, you're up to 80, 20% for the writing project. Right. So you probably noticed too, this is a bottom heavy course. So right at the 11th hour, all of your forms will come in, your last test will come in, and your writing project will come in. So what's that? 55% of your grade that you will have access to and control of right until the last minute of the class. And I do this because I figure, you know, with time, as you get used to the online course and the course material and the style of study that a philosophical approach to ethics involves, you're going to get better. I expect this to be a learning curve. You wouldn't need this class if you were already great at this. So I try to build in to the course structure by which, if you're struggling at the beginning of the course, plenty of room for you to recuperate at the end of the course. Of course, I expect you to be awesome right from the start, right? So that said, if something happens, then there's plenty of recovery time built right into the course. So those are the assignments. If you have questions about how you're going to be evaluated for any of this, please email me, come talk to me, that sort of thing. Now on to my least favorite part of any introductory lecture, course policies. You'll see it's a substantial section on page 2 of the syllabus. It's substantial because I've had problems in the past. So to be clear, these policies aren't here because I think that you're bad people who are going to pull a fast one on me. They are here because I like to solve problems before they're problems. So if I have a problem in the past, I make a policy. And then there is that policy, which tells you where you stand, obligates me to a particular standing, so that everything is just plain and simple and black and white right off the bat, right? Make sense? Hopefully, right? The first one we find is plagiarism, and this is a big deal. It has been a big deal. I've had a lot of cases go to the Dean of Students office, especially in an online format. All of this material is just there and so easy to just grab from online sources. I've noticed students are actually getting better at plagiarizing, which makes my work a whole lot harder. If I think I've got a case of plagiarism, I spend a lot of time actually making sure it's a case of plagiarism, because this isn't an accusation I make lightly. Right? And it's not even a judgment that I'm technically allowed to make. If I suspect plagiarism, there is a procedure in my contract that means if I suspect it, it's got to go to the Dean of Students office and they prove that it's a case of plagiarism. I present them with evidence and that sort of thing. And like I say, it's not an accusation I make lightly. But nonetheless, it's just what I'm contractually obligated to do. So plagiarism. What is plagiarism? Well, right from the student handbook, policies and procedures, and I give you the link there, you'll note there's a footnote. The OU policy on plagiarism is stated, as and they define it, plagiarizing the work of others. Plagiarism is using someone else's work or ideas without giving that person credit. By doing this, a student is, in effect, claiming credit for someone else's thinking. Whether the student has read or heard the information used, the student must document the source of the information. You know that sick feeling you get in your stomach when somebody else tells your joke, right? Your joke resting on a story about something that happened to you, right? As though it had happened to them, as though it was their joke. There's that moment where you go, hey, right? That's not your joke. That's not your story. That didn't happen to you. It happened to me. Right? Well, effectively, plagiarism is that, right? It's ripping off somebody else's insight, right? Somebody's humor, someone else's word, someone else's content, right? It's rampant on the internet, which is to some extent why it's hard to detect, because when I find what I think is someone else's source, what I find is that it's all over without attribution on the internet. It's all over the place. People are just grabbing things and posting them to their web pages. So who knows where you got it? But if I have six web sources or one web source, right, I know it's come from the internet and not your noggin, right? So in other words, you're stealing someone else's punchline, or in this case, someone else's intellectual property. It's theft, is what it is, right? So, when dealing with written sources, a clear distinction should be made between quotations, which reproduce the information from the source word for word within quotation marks, and paraphrases, which digest the source of information and produce it in the student's own words. Both direct quotations and paraphrases must be documented. You see, there's such a thing as fair use. Let me show you something. Right over here, this is what I had to do to get my PhD. This is my dissertation. It's a big, long, makes a satisfying clunk when you dump it on a desk. This is my original contribution to the field, right? And how many footnotes did I have by the end of the thing? There's my last one, just shy 600. Just shy 600 footnotes. Right. So, I mean, you're allowed to use this information that's out there. If you find an analysis offered by somebody online to be very, very helpful, you'll find I Rely on Analyses, you'll find Michael Sandel, you'll find Rick Roderick, you'll find a few others in this class. Alain de Botton is another guy that I refer to because I find how he puts it is communicative to students. But I don't pretend these are my ideas. When I'm using other people's ideas, I say, hi, I'm using these people's ideas, and what I think is interesting about these ideas is this. You're allowed to use other people's ideas. You just have to say, hi, I'm using someone else's idea. Right? You just have to indicate the partition between someone else's idea and your analysis. It's fine to use somebody else's ideas. Right? But really, on top of that, especially in a course like this, what I'm looking for you to do and where your grades come from is from your analysis. Quotations, other people's ideas should only be used as fodder or as evidence for the claims that you provide through your analysis. Right? So, even if you rephrase, condense, select from another person's work, and back to the policy from OU here, right, the ideas are still the other person's, and failure to give credit constitutes misrepresentation of the student's actual work and plagiarism of another's ideas. Buying a paper or using information from the World Wide Web or internet without attribution and handing it as one's own work is plagiarism. You may laugh at that, but you'd be shocked to see how often it actually happens. So don't do it. Why? I have a course policy on plagiarism, and that course policy, if you do it, and I'm hoping you won't, right? And I'm not accusing you of anything because I just met you, right, virtually. I don't know what you're going to do yet, right? But what I'm trying to spell out to you is, first off, this is an issue, and secondly, there are consequences if you do this. This is meant to help you in terms of your cost-benefit analysis. There will be a zero-tolerance policy on plagiarism in this course. Any student suspected of this form of theft, and it's theft, will automatically be passed on to an academic review board, and that board through the Dean of Students office. That's just what I'm contractually obligated to do. Expulsion from the university is possible. They could kick you out of school. Of course, policy for this offense will be automatic failure of not the assignment, not the question, the course. You fail the whole course if you do this, right? So, I don't know. How much do you pay for a course? It's over 1,000, right? That's what it costs you if you do this. And I'm also going to warn you, I've got sort of a wacky sort of sixth sense for this sort of thing. I can look at a document and determine, right, by some sort of intuition, whether this is your work or not. Right? So if it's not your work, put a footnote on it and analyze it yourself. That's where your grades come from anyway. You see, you plagiarize. My job is to figure out how well you understand this material and figure out how well you're able to communicate about these ideas in your written work. If you hand me somebody else's written work, I don't know any of those things, and I can't assess you. Right? So, this is a massive time investment on my part. Right? It cost me a lot of time, and in the past I've had a lot of students upset with me because my grades take a long time to turn over. But if I am detecting plagiarism and I am being vigilant with regard to this issue, as I'm required contractually to do as part of my job, and it takes a long time to isolate a block of text, search it out on the internet, read 7 other articles about this that I found on the internet that might be your sources, and determine which ones are your sources, etc., etc. It takes me probably 5 times as long to research a possible case of plagiarism as it takes you to write the assignment. It probably takes you just as long to plagiarize well, right, as it would to just bloody well write the assignment. So just bloody well write the assignment. Finger wag, finger wag. And I know you haven't done anything yet. You're probably very nice people. So anyhow, don't do that, and that entire policy doesn't apply. Simple, right? Missed assignment policy. I'm the first one to understand that life happens. One, I come from Canada, and I have missed classes because the Department of Homeland Security has pulled me into secondary inspection and left me there for hours. Right? Things happen that are outside your control. I have, nearly 2-year-old twin girls who are in daycare. Guess what daycare is? A breeding ground for just about every illness out there. I get sick, my girls get sick, my partner gets sick, we wind up covering for one another, we wind up incapacitated, laying in bed, sick, right? Sometimes life happens. I have a daughter with very, very, very complex medical needs. It's one of the twins, right? Sometimes there's going to be a need for a procedure or a surgery or something along those lines, right? These things are awful, but they happen. Life happens. I realize that, especially in the context of an ethics course, you, like me, are probably going to have all sorts of conflicting duties and obligations and unexpected scenarios come up, and I am perfectly willing to work with you with regard to the happenings of life, provided you work with me, and that's why I have this policy. In the unfortunate event that you miss an assignment due to a serious illness or a death in the family or a serious life occurrence, I might add, you must notify me via email or by a telephone message with the departmental office or somehow, either before the date and time in question or within 12 hours of the deadline or due date. Otherwise, I will not be able to offer an extension. Sounds tough, doesn't it? But I'm actually not asking for a lot there. I prefer you let me know, oh, professor, I don't think I'm going to be able to get this done because I've been sick, right? Or I've had a family emergency, or you know, my apartment was broken into and they stole my laptop that had my in-process exam on it or something along those lines. These things happen, and I'm perfectly willing to work with you just so long as you work with me. Just let me know and we'll work something out. I sound tough here, but I'm actually really, really, really flexible. The one issue with extensions, though, is that I don't start grading until I've got all of the assignments. Why? Because as soon as I grade your assignment, you have feedback. And if you're friends with the person who has the extension, that feedback includes an answer key for the assignment. It includes, you know, some critical feedback for your, you know, you've got both the questions and the answers. So if you submit the answers based on the answer key, then what am I testing, really, right? I have to test your ability to figure it out. So these deadlines are meant to be strong suggestions to you. But if something happens, of course, I'm going to work with you. Just try to keep asking for an extension as the last resort. Do everything in your power to meet these deadlines. And if you see a deadline, and they're all right here, right, that you're not going to be able to meet, contact me way, way early, and we'll work something out. Make sense? Hopefully. So, assignment submission. I'm teaching four sections this semester. I've got three sections of ethics and one section of introduction to philosophy, and that means there are a lot of you. A lot of you. There are just a bloody ton of you, right? It's, if these courses are fully enrolled, or over-enrolled, it should put me at something like 160 students. Given that, I can't go chasing after you for your assignments. I mean, when I grade, that's when I find out if you've submitted or not, right? When I go to grade, that's when I find out if you've submitted a corrupt document, the wrong document, or the correct document, or any document at all, right? So, I have to say, not to be a jerk, but I have to say, just in the interest of workflow, that it's got to be your responsibility to ensure that assignments have been properly uploaded to Moodle. When you submit your assignment, be sure to double check that your upload was successful. If I don't have it, it's not there. All right. So, I mean, effectively, right, this is just like if you were handing me an assignment on a piece of paper in a classroom. It's your responsibility to get it to me. Once I have it, through Moodle in this case, it's my responsibility to assess it properly. Right? But you gotta get me the right assignment. I've had people upload their communications or English homework rather than the philosophy test. I've had people submit incomplete documents or early draft versions. I've had people say they've submitted when there's nothing on my end in Moodle, that sort of thing. You're best to double check, and you're best to be redundant too. So submit to Moodle, email it to me, and make sure you've got the right email address. Right? So that's your responsibility. Right? Speaking of the right email address, a couple of things about that. Given the high volume of emails I get in a semester, I'm going to do my best to stay as on top of email as possible, but I do fall behind. It's just foregone that I'm going to fall behind at some point this semester. So, please be patient. Understand that the best way to ask me a question is in person. So, come to my office hours, ask me questions. If not, please be patient with regard to emails. I try to prioritize the students in the online classes, but Gmail, OU email doesn't allow me to filter through that way quite as readily as I'd like. So you might get lost. I hope not, but And on top of that, Oakland University likes to own things. So Oakland University requires that all course correspondence actually occur through OU email addresses. So if you email from me from your private Hotmail or Gmail or me.com or whatever sort of email address, I'm not even supposed to reply, right? So get that OU email address up and running, and away we go, okay? All right, so one last thing with email. Sometimes I email my wife in the other room, and it takes 6 hours for her to get the email. I don't know why, but sometimes it happens. So it's not super instant, right? It's not like sending a text message, and even text messages are not super, super instant all the time, right? So a couple more policies here. We're almost done, don't worry. I know we're 45 minutes into this, right? But discussion forum content policy, the idea is keep it classy, keep it topical. All right. These are teaching resources, these forums, learning resources. So what you should do is make sure that you keep it topical. It's not to discuss your weekend. It's not to not there to ask about, hey, did you get your grade back from that? How'd you do, et cetera, et cetera. It's not your Facebook page, right? It's not, you know, it's not your texting with a friend. It's not a blog or anything along those lines. It's an instructional resource. So the Socrates forum should have discussion of Socrates, right? The Aristotle forum should have et cetera, et cetera, right? Then on top of that, each and every bloody one of these guys is going to be asking you to engage uncomfortable, personal, cultural, religious, hot button topics. And by engaging with this material, each and every one of these theorists is probably going to get a little under your collar. Why? Because each and every one of them, insofar as they're ethicists, are telling you what to do. They're saying that the only right way to act is this, and you're wrong if you don't act that way. Right? They're going to come down hard on issues. And you should be critical of these guys, and you should be critical of one another as you analyze and work your way through this material and as you develop your own positions. Right? And I invite you to bring a certain degree of yourself into the discussions in this class. But when you're critiquing the positions on the forums offered by other people, critique the position, not the person. Right? Any personal, derogatory, hateful, inflammatory kind of response, any sort of attack of the person, constitutes a big problem, right? So I've got this policy here. The discussion board for this course is intended and should only be used for discussion of the course material. Procedural questions and general comments about the course. When are we getting our grades back? How did everybody else do on that exam? Should be directed to either to my email or should be discussed in person via office hours, class meetings, or in personal correspondence to one another, not the forums. Then in italics, stronger language, there will be a zero tolerance policy for derogatory comments or personal attacks on this forum. Posts of this nature will be removed and grade deductions will ensue. This is an instructional resource and should only be treated, or it should not be treated like a personal blog or a more general forum, right? It's not the comment section on the Detroit Free Press. Right? It's not the comment section and the Guardian or anything along those lines. This is an instructional resource and it's governed by OU policies, right, relating to conduct, right? So I've happily never had a really severe case of derogatory. And by the way, when you're logged into these forums, that's you, that's your name that somebody is using. So make sure that if you step away from your computer, either in the library or in the cafeteria or in your dorm or in your home, right? If somebody else has access to your computer and you're logged in and post something in your name, you're responsible for that. That's you, right? So you're going to be held responsible for keeping it classy and keeping it topical, right, for that forum. And hopefully it can be fun and an open and a safe and a really valuable learning environment for everyone. And then finally, before you even ask, there will be no extra credit assignments in this course. The credit is the credit. I've tried to be fairly lenient with regard to assignments and due dates and expectations and that sort of thing. Each of the tests will have some sort of a video attached to it where I go over the questions and tell you what I'm looking for. You'll have 5 days to get in contact with me to discuss this material. Some of those days will be office hour days. So you can come and talk to me in person about the material for the test, that sort of thing. My advice, page 4, print it, keep it on your desk. Hence the page with the important dates and the tentative schedule. I say the tentative schedule is tentative because sometimes we fall behind, sometimes life happens, that sort of thing. And sometimes there are going to be technological problems through Moodle or through, I've had semesters where, you know, webmail has gone down. You're not getting my emails, I'm not getting your emails, and it's really sort of a horrible thing. All right, so if something like that happens, then we're going to have to adjust this. Right, but if all goes as planned, this is the schedule. So section test 1 is due Monday, February 6th. Section test 2 done Monday, March 13th. Section test 3 due Monday, April 24th. They're Mondays, so it's a Monday theme. You've got weekends for each of this. I will point out section test 3. I'm going to be posting that on April 10th, and you'll have till April 24th. That's 2 weeks. I do that partially because you've also got a writing assignment that you're grappling with in that same period of time, so you've got lots of time with that assignment. All right. You've got time to come to my office hours. You've got time to email me questions. You've got time to think it through and work on it for that assignment. The other one's 5 days. So I post on Wednesdays. So like, for example, for the first test, February 1st, Wednesday, it will be posted to Moodle before noon. And Monday, February 6th, it will be due at noon. All right, so that should be plenty of time to work on that. The schedule is broken down by weeks. Week 1, January 4th to 6th. Week 2 and 3, January 9th to the 20th. Right? It tells you what we're studying when, what materials you're going to be responsible for, what video materials, what readings. So it should be really, really straightforward. Last thing we're going to discuss. When I do this on campus, I pause for applause, and then I immediately tell you why it doesn't matter. The last page of the syllabus is the grading scheme. Take a look at it, let it sink in for a second. Anything below a 50 does not get credit in the course. D's are 50 all the way up to 59.9. C's are 60 all the way up to 69.9, B's are 70 all the way to 79.9, and the A range starts at 80 and goes all the way up to 100. I've got all the gradations sort of in there. These are percentage points, so these relate to the grades that you're getting on each of these assignments. So if you got a 16 out of 20 on the first assignment, the first test, What you got was an 80, which is an A minus. So this is where I normally say pause for applause. Now, let me tell you why this doesn't matter. The first time that I was teaching a course of my own in the States, right, my first job was for University of Michigan, and this grade scheme is just standard. It's what I grew up with. It's pretty well ubiquitous in Canadian institutions, right? It's I've come from exclusively Canadian institutions. I've taken courses at York. I've taken courses at University of Windsor. I've taken courses at Brock. I've sat in on courses at McMaster, University of Toronto, etc. Right? I've been around the bailiwick. Right? I've even traveled in Canada, studied a bit in Montreal, studied a bit in like British Columbia, that sort of thing. This is generally standard. Right. This is so effectively all throughout my embarrassing number of years of education. This is just what an A means. If I want to give something an A, I mean higher than 80. Right. If I want to give something a B, I mean somewhere in the 70s, C somewhere in the 60s, etc. That's just what I mean. Now, the Office of the Registrar never sees a percentage grade from you. The Office of the Registrar likewise never sees a letter grade from you. So at the end of the course, when I'm calculating your grade, what I do is I take your percentage grade, and by the chart that I've given you on here, I transfer it into a letter grade. And then the Office of the Registrar gives me this one down here. So you've gone through the course. You've got an 81.5 in the course. I know that's an A minus. And since the A minus range ranges from 80 all the way up to 85.9, I know it's a low A minus. So what I do is I take that low A minus down to this chart and see that, oh, you've got a 3.6. And that's what I submit to the Office of the Registrar. So if you got an A, you get an A. You get a B, you get a B, that sort of thing. The percentage point, what your percentage translates to in terms of a letter grade, I put this here just so you're not freaked out. In the first class that I taught for U of M, I didn't know that this wasn't standard. I thought this was just assumed. I thought everybody did this, but I was doing something culturally specific to Canadian institutions. So I passed back the first batch of tests, and I had people confronting me in tears in the parking lot of the school. Why am I failing this course? And it's like, well, let's see what you got. No, that's not a failure, that's a C. You're not failing the course. There's room for improvement, but that's a C. It's a C, right? This actually happened, right? So this is my way of saying, even before I give you a grade, don't freak out. This is what your grade means, right? So to Moodle, I've decided I'm going to post something from an old professor of mine. It's called a What Your Grade Means kind of thing. It's an interesting document, and in plain language describes when I give you an A range grade, what the incredible sort of comment on your performance that I'm making. When I give you a B range grade, these are the things that you need to improve, but these are the things that you got really right, right, et cetera, et cetera. I'm going to post that to Moodle. This week, since we are doing a general introduction to philosophy as part of what we are doing, you see on the tentative schedule, week one, syllabus, course policy, overview, that's what we just did now, and a general historical introduction to philosophy. I've got a video for that. I'll post that to Moodle today. And that will be up for you as well. So that's going to go up. And what else am I going to post for you? Well, the syllabus is already up. You got it in that email. And starting next week, we will get into the Socrates material. You'll expect videos, my video, and you should get reading that material. We're just reading the Apology and the Credo. The Apology is Socrates' trial defense. And the Credo is sort of a dialogue that occurs after the trial. I'm not going to sort of give you a spoiler for that quite yet. So I'm looking forward to an interesting discussion with you guys this semester. I hope it will be interesting for you as well. If you have any questions about the course, please feel free to come and see me. I'm on campus on Wednesday and on Friday from, 11:45 to 12:45. Thank you, and have good days, one for each of you. Cheers.